I'm Catherine Telez with Eureka College, and today I'm joined by Yusef Salaam, one of the five teens wrongfully convicted of rape and assault in New York City's Central Park back in 1989.
I guess let's just start off by, tell us a little bit about your story. And when you were 15, you were convicted of rape and assault, wrongfully convicted. Tell us a little bit about how that came to be, the process of that.
So, the backdrop of the story of the Central Park Jogger case is there were some young people hanging out in the park having fun. And things in some ways may have gotten out of hand, young people doing what young people do, but no one thought that what they were doing was going to lead to being arrested, you know. The long and short of it, in a way, I'm trying to think about the whole story, but the long and short of it is that we all went home that night and thought nothing else of it. You know, those of us who had done things that I want to say was maybe more questionable, you know, were unfortunately not any of the Central Park Five. You know, it's weird how that whole story kind of comes about. None of the Central Park Five actually were involved in any of the actual assaults on anyone in the park. Most of us were witnesses to it, you know. Me, myself, I kind of thought we were going to go to the park and hang out and have fun and do what we've always done, which is, you know, we would go around the park and, you know, of course, take young ladies walking around the mirror, you know. It was much more smellier back then, but that's what we did, you know. And the next day, the media is going crazy. And they're talking about this young lady that was raped in the park. You know, and some of the individuals who became known as the Central Park Five were arrested that night, and they were at the precinct, they were being interrogated, and they went through this long process. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the whole interrogation process, but they weren't given anything to eat or drink, and they weren't even allowed to sleep. And through that process, they were coerced into making false confessions. But these false confessions were not even similar to any of the other confessions that were being given. You know, every false confession was saying things that were completely different from one another. And then all of a sudden they were looking for me. And they were looking for me because, of course, I had been in the park. I was a very tall guy. I was about the same height as I am right now. I've been this height maybe since I was 12 years old. So, and plus I had a flat top, and I had art designs on my pants, and I had a sky blue outfit on. I was very, very visible. And I mention that because when you think about assaults that happen, and when you think about crime and things like that, usually the victim remembers something about the person or persons that assaulted them. And I wasn't picked out of any lineup. As a matter of fact, the people that were getting assaulted would come to they came to the trial, and they were looking at us, and they were like, it wasn't any of these guys, you know. But they still made the story stick to us the way the media controlled it, you know.
Talk a little bit about, I know you verbally confessed to it in that interrogation, but you never signed anything, it was never videotaped. So for those people out there who are like, well, why did you say you did it?
Well, so I didn't actually verbally confess. That's what the police told them. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the unfortunate story about the Central Park Jogger case and the Central Park Jogger trials was never owned by us. Like, we never had any control over it. The media and the police department were the ones that were really shaping everything, every single step of this story they shaped, you know. So much so that if you look at the old news reports, you'll see five confessions. And you'll see, if you look closely, one of the guy's photos is there twice. Because I had never told him that I did it. I never made a written videotape confession or even a verbal confession. But they told the people that I did.
So going forward, you know, to today, and when you see what's going on in today's world, you know, and how the media is portraying it, do you think that anything has changed over, you know, it's been more than 20 years, and just, you know, with, you know, some of the police shootings out there and things that happen, and how the media is so involved and front and center with that. Do you see differences there?
I want to say that some things have changed, but a lot of things have still remained the same. The system itself is still the same system. The thing that has changed has been the people. You know, the social media aspect has changed. You know, this recent story about some young people in Brooklyn who happened upon a man and a woman, and as the story goes, somebody pulled out a gun and told the man to get lost, you know, something like that. And they said that the men then raped the young lady. Of course, there was a huge outcry, but because of social media and because of the fact that everyone is kind of like in this camera age, you know, you got to see the video footage, right? The story turned out, at least now, at this point in the story, turned out to be nothing from what the initial reports were, you know. There's a lot of things that still, I think there's a lot of things that still happen as a result of personal bias, and just because people think this is what the truth is, but then when people investigate it more, that bias changes. You know?
Do you still encounter, you know, even though you were exonerated and you know, they said that it wasn't you, do you still today face with the racism and that bias in your life?
Absolutely. You know, the funny thing about today is that the way that the Central Park Jogger case was told, it was so convincing. People believed that we were the ones that did it. Even the Central Park Jogger herself, you know, this whole process took 13 years. And when I say 13 years, meaning we went to prison, and some of us came home from prison at 7 years. And at the 13-year mark, the truth comes out. And the Central Park Jogger, and of course I haven't spoken to her, but the Central Park Jogger was led to believe that we were the ones that did this. And then all of a sudden the story changes. And now it's not five people raping the Central Park Jogger, but one guy. And not only is it one guy, it's actually a murderer, you know. Wow. You know, sometimes I think back at that time and I'm like physically transported back to that time frame and going through the same emotions and everything. This case would have, in many ways, not been told had it not been for this truth coming out. You know, had it not been for after the truth came out, 10 years after that, Ken Burns making the great film, The Central Park Five, you know, Chronicle of the City Wilding, you know. But even with all of these various mediums to our disposal, there's still that question that people have that says something about this case doesn't fit, and I think these guys, they had to be guilty of something, you know. And so that always presents itself. And it presents itself more when I encounter people who've never had a chance to see the Central Park Five film, or people who've never heard us speak before, or anything like that. You know, once they get a chance to actually engage with us, it's like, these guys aren't anything like the media portrayed them to be, or like I believe them to be, you know.
So where do you really think, looking back at the justice system as when you went through it, you know, like 15 to today, are there really that many differences that would make it better or make it so that these kinds of things don't happen as often?
No, we still have a lot of strides to make sure that this doesn't happen again. And I say that because we're still fighting for this one law that we want to put on the books. And the law really entails having the videotape of the custodial interrogations be present as well. You know, usually what happens is after people get arrested and then you see these confessions on video, you see the end result of this whole drawn out process. Like I said, with Central Park Five, many of them had been interrogated for 36 hours. You know, it would have been important to see what was the process like that got them to confess. because every single one of us said we didn't do it. But at some point, four of the guys began to say, okay, I need this to stop, you know. But the problem with the justice system itself there's a saying in our community that the system is broken and needs to be fixed. And there's also a saying that the system was designed and built that way. It's actually working exactly as it was designed. And the unfortunate reality is when we look at the history of the police department and how it was born and really where it came from, we're looking at a really horrible part of our own history in America. The whole thing about slavery and, catching runaway slaves and the whole history about the KKK, and when we look at the way the police department, like I said, came about as a result of these things, some of us have chosen to try to make change by joining that system. And unfortunately, sometimes it's the ones who look like us who treat us the worst, And I've even had experiences like that myself, So in a way, I would say, if I was to give it a percentage, I would say it's maybe still 75% bad.
That's more than 20 years after.
Yeah. Back when, you would walk in the 50s and 40s and the 60s and you would see signs up that would say for whites only, in a way you appreciated that more because you knew that this was what it was. When they removed those signs, and now systemically, I can't come into your shops to spend money. There's a story in New York City maybe a year or so ago. A young man had saved his money and went into a really high-end store and bought a belt with his own money. Left the store, had the receipt and everything, left the store and was stopped and arrested as he was leaving the store because they couldn't believe that he had enough money to buy this belt. It's crazy.
So for college students, we're on a college campus who see this happening, who are aware that this happens and they want to shake up the system and they want to be a part of the change that people say needs to happen, what can be done? I mean, if more than 20 years later you're saying it's still 75% bad, what do you think really needs to happen?
Well, I think that we're at a place today, which is really great. College students today are more plugged in than ever. And I say that because, the so-called good old boys way of doing things is falling to the wayside. People are becoming more socially connected with other people's cultures and the way people do things. And as a result of that, I'm more optimistic of the future generation that's to come. These individuals who are law students, these individuals who are involved in criminal justice, these individuals who are involved in media, I'm more optimistic that they will approach things in a much different way than things have been approached. And that gives me hope because, if someone is gonna take the time to say, wait, let's make sure the backstory is correct and let's make sure that we check our facts. We don't wanna just hear what the police officer said, but we want to make sure that once we report it, and we have to be quick about it, that we report it correctly. I think that in a way we're in a very good place.
And so when you see that happening, especially with some of the cases in Chicago and all the backstories that are really coming out, are you proud that that's happening?
Absolutely. Oh man, that like I said, that gives me hope. That tells me, I've been known to call it the criminal system of injustice. And it's not, when I say that, I'm not just talking about one piece, because one piece feeds the other. You know, so when stories get put out in the media, these stories are being told to them through the police department contacts. And so if the contacts are being told the correct story, and then those stories that are coming out in the media are being told correctly, there's hope.
So
at least we'll get a fair chance. And that, if we have to go to trial, the people in the trial, even though they're told not to read the papers or look at the news, you know, they'll be plugged in enough to at least give us a fairer chance.
Do you think that today's the generation can take it and change it? Do you think in 20 years it could be, in 10 years it could be different?
Absolutely. I think it definitely can. There's a lot of people that still want things to be the way they have always been. But I think that the new generation of people, the generation that's plugged in, they're going to do astronomical things. They're going to really, we're going to see some really good things happen. Unfortunately, we're going to see some bad things happen as well, but we're definitely going to see some really, really good things happen as a result of this new generation of thinkers.
So what is your advice to that new generation who wants to change it?
Be the change. Because see, if we're going, let's say I'm a prospective person that's going to be hired by a big media company, or a police department, or a DA's office. If I am the change, you know, that's the best mental place to be. But if you're going in there, and I'm not saying you have to be the change, like, okay, you're gonna go in and shake things up. No, go in there, learn the system, understand what it is that you need to do, but be the change. Be that change that you want to happen. You know, when we look at, the Martin Luther King holiday and the fact that, you know, he spoke about this dream, like everyone talks about the dream, I have a dream, and what that dream means. And if that's true, if that's something that everyone wants to see, be that. And if everyone can basically say, you know what, I'm gonna take that piece of Martin and put it inside of me and allow it to blossom, we'll be all right.